Welcome to the PV online course on grid-connected PV system. This chapter deals with solar radiation. In this particular teaching unit, we will have a closer look on terrestrial solar radiation, hence the solar energy which hits the Earth's surface. In the previous teaching unit, we learned that the average extraterrestrial solar irradiation reaching the outer atmosphere of the Earth is 1,367 watt per square meter. These are the air mass zero or AM zero conditions. However, when this solar radiation enters the Earth's atmosphere, some of it will be absorbed, scattered, or reflected. This means that the solar irradiance is reduced as it is crossing the atmosphere. The absorption is caused by molecules in the atmosphere like nitrogen, oxygen, ozone, CO2, or H2O. This absorption process is one element of the total atmospheric attenuation. After crossing the atmosphere 1.5 times, the solar irradiance is reduced to a value of 1000 watt per square meter when reaching the ground. This value, 1000 watt per square meter or 100 milliwatt per square centimeter of air mass 1.5, is also used for standard testing conditions, STC, for solar cells and modules. The attenuation between AM0 and AM1.5 solar irradiance is 27%, which corresponds to the difference between 1,367 and 1,000 watt per square meter divided by the AM0 irradiance, hence 1,367 watt per square meter. The direction of this part of the radiation is not passing through clouds and is called direct beam radiation. Some of the radiation represented by the central arrow in the picture will be reflected from the ground. This part of the radiation becomes important when dealing with inclined modules like described in one of the next units. Some of the radiation represented by the third arrow from the left will be either reflected or scattered, for example by clouds. Scattering will lead to diffuse radiation, hence solar radiation, which comes from all directions of the hemisphere. The air mass is the ratio of the actual path of sunlight through the atmosphere to the shortest path of sunlight through the atmosphere. In other words, the larger the air mass, the larger the path through the atmosphere. That means that the losses of solar radiation increase as the air mass increases. The air mass is inversely proportional to the sinus of gamma S being the sun elevation angle. The shortest path of sunlight through the atmosphere is air mass 1, when the sun position is perpendicular or normal to the Earth's surface. This, by the way, only occurs in the tropics. In Cologne, the minimum air mass is 1.1, and it is reached at noon around June 22nd, when the sun elevation angle is 62.5 degrees, as you can see in this picture. The lowest sun elevation angle at noon in Cologne occurs around December 21st. Its value is 15.6 degrees. And the corresponding air mass is 3.7. AM1.5 correspond to a sun elevation angle of 41.8. This diagram shows the solar spectra at AM0 and at AM1.5. The x-axis displays the wavelengths in nanometer. On the y-axis, the radiation intensity in watt per nanometer and square meter is shown. The gray spectrum represents the extraterrestrial solar radiation at AM0, and the red spectrum the terrestrial solar radiation at AM1.5. Water vapor and CO2 and other gas molecules absorb part of the light coming from the sun. The spectrum of solar radiation is changed, leading to the AM1.5 spectrum observed on the Earth. Scattering of sunlight can be divided into two major processes, Rayleigh scattering and Mie scattering. Rayleigh scattering takes place when the size of the scattering particles is much smaller than the wavelengths of the light. This is the case for air molecules. Mie scattering takes place when the size of the particles is comparable to the wavelengths of the scattered light, rather than much smaller or much larger. Aerosols, dust, pollen, smoke, and water droplets do have these properties. To fully understand Rayleigh scattering, would have to go quite deep into electromagnetic processes. For this teaching unit, it is sufficient to know that Rayleigh scattering takes place at molecules in the upper atmosphere, and that the amount of scattering is inversely proportional to the force power of the wavelengths. Hence, blue light with a wavelength of 400 nanometer is scattered 10 times more than the red light with a wavelength of 700 nanometer. The emission of the scattered light takes place into all hemispheric directions. We, as observers on the ground, see the scattered light from all directions, and this scattered light is mainly blue, as only a much smaller radiation density of the other wavelengths are scattered. Hence, the sky appears blue. On the other hand, as most of the blue light is scattered, the rest of the direct beam appears yellow. In case of sunlight with high elevation angle, or reddish in case of sunlight with low elevation angle, where even the green and yellow light will be largely scattered. Mie scattering is much easier. In this case, the amount of scattering is almost not wavelength dependent. Mie scattering can take place in clouds, and there's Mie scattering by dust, aerosols, and water droplets, which we cannot see. Both lead to the effect that we will see white or a gray sky, as all wavelengths are scattered equally. This picture shows a view into the valley of Cochabamba, Bolivia, in the early morning, demonstrating Mie scattering. The sunlight is traveling a long distance through the atmosphere, and due to the pollution with aerosol in this highly populated area, a high amount of Mie scattering is causing a white sky appearance. The picture on the right has been taken a few hours later, around noon, at an altitude of 4,600 meters over sea level, viewing the Andes in Bolivia near Cochabamba. Under these circumstances, the sunlight is traveling only a short distance through the atmosphere. As the dominant process is Rayleigh scattering, the sky appears in dark blue. Towards the horizon, however, with increasing inclination, the observer can see more Mie scattering, with light traveling a longer distance through the atmosphere, and the sky appears more white blue. With the help of the next three slides, the difference between global, direct, and diffuse irradiance is explained. The direct radiation is also called beam horizontal. It is the direct radiation reaching an horizontal surface on the Earth. The beam horizontal, BH, is part of the extraterrestrial solar radiation that reaches a surface on the ground without a change, but being attenuated. Opposed to this definition, we find the diffuse horizontal irradiance, DHI, which is part of the radiation that is scattered in the atmosphere. Under a cloudy sky, all light results from diffused skylight radiation. Diffuse radiation cannot be assigned to a specific direction. It cannot be concentrated and does not create shadows. The global horizontal irradiance, GHI, is the sum of the direct solar irradiation and the diffuse solar irradiance, as indicated by the mathematical formula GHI equals BH plus DHI. This diagram shows a day with low irradiation in Cologne in August. The x-axis shows the time in hours, the y-axis the irradiance in watt per square meter. The gray area represents the solar energy from diffuse radiation, the orange-red are the solar energy from direct radiation. Almost 100% of the irradiation is diffuse. The next picture displays a day with high irradiation in Cologne. Less than 40% of the global radiation is diffuse. The rest is direct radiation. This diagram shows the irradiance for a whole year in Cologne. Again, the x-axis represents the time in months, and the y-axis the average irradiance on a whole day, including the night. It can be seen that the solar energy from diffuse radiation is higher than the solar energy from direct radiation on an horizontal surface. Throughout the year, the average ratio of diffuse radiation is around 60%. The second diagram shows the irradiance for a whole year in Santiago de Chile, which is on a latitude of minus 33 degrees in the southern hemisphere. It can be seen that the irradiance in June, July, the winter time in the southern hemisphere, is much lower than in December or January. Nevertheless, the average ratio of diffuse radiation is only 50% in winter and even 35% in summer, which is no surprise as Santiago is in the subtropics and hence much closer to the equator than Cologne, explaining the higher quantity of direct radiation on a horizontal surface. The most important takeaways of this teaching units are: extraterrestrial solar radiation is attenuated by absorption, scattering, and reflection. A longer path through the atmosphere is accompanied by a larger air mass and thus higher losses. The spectrum of the solar radiation changes as it passes through the atmosphere due to wavelength-dependent attenuation. Scattering leads to diffuse radiation, which cannot be assigned to a specific direction. Global terrestrial horizontal irradiance, GHI, consists of direct horizontal irradiance, BH, and diffuse horizontal irradiance, DHI. Thank you for your attention.